breakfast puppies?
This podcast contains adult language and content and is meant for mature audiences. Listener discretion is advised.
We're all set to begin, so let's dive right in to Bikers, Dice, and Bars. Talking bicycles and motorbikes, gamer things and all the like. You can listen to it in your cars, but mostly it's about dive bars. Bikers, Dice, and Bars.
Hey, NPC, what are we drinking?
We are drinking Teeling Spirit of Dublin Whiskey Small Batch Irish Whiskey.
Ooh.
You know what I have to say? This is quite tasty.
I wanted to start our drinks this evening with something that I figured that we would all agree was not crappy. Because we may or may not have some crappier things down the line.
Uh-oh.
We'll see.
Is this our pre-palate cleanser?
This is the, yeah. This is the palate pleaser.
I see.
I just looked over at what you have. One of them looks amazing. One of them makes me want to throw my drink in your face.
Well, we'll see if that threat comes through.
Speaking of threats,
you're listening to Bikers, Dice, and Bars.
Are you threatening me?
Recorded here in Portland, Oregon. I'm NPC.
I'm the good Dr. Xander Gerrymander.
I'm just Jacob over here. I'm not here today.
I'm Poppy Beaujolais. Just Jacob is on his way, frantically fighting Portland rush hour traffic to come join us for our recording this evening.
Allegedly.
Allegedly. Yeah, there's a good chance he might just show up in the middle of the recording. So we'll see how that works out.
Sounds like a good time to me. Yeah,
this is the real world, yo.
Speaking of the real world, Xander, I understand you have a story from the pits, the battle zones, the constant war zone that is downtown Portland.
I do. So a few months ago, I was in Old Town outside of the lovely Kit Kat Club, which if anyone ever wants to see one of Portland's premier strip clubs, Kit Kat Club is a way to go. Anyways, my lesbian best friend Snack was in from Huntington Beach. And I call her my lesbian bestie. And she wanted to go to a strip club. And so I showed up there a little early. And outside of the club was this fucking Capital Storming militia looking fucking 3%er looking motherfucker. And I'm talking flak jacket. I'm talking pepper spray, restraints, stun gun, and like a fucking 9mm on his hip.
Okay, question. 3%er?
Oh, they're a far right wing anti-government militia type crazy motherfuckers.
Hmm. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Their name comes from the false notion that only 3% of people in the American Revolution volunteered to fight against the British. It's been a disproven myth, but that's where they get their name from.
Hmm.
Anyways, like this guy looked like a militia dude. And I was like, that's fucking strange. I had not been in Old Town for a while. So, okay. So I asked the bouncer, what the hell's going on? He goes, oh, because cops don't show up in downtown Portland anymore, all these clubs have hired a bunch of private security firms to go and do security for them, and they're armed. And I went, okay, I thought that was a gun. That's cool. So my initial instinct was to go and text one of my reporter friends from the Willamette Week, Aaron Mesh, and he went, what? He goes, that's a fascinating tip. Do you want to go out next weekend to the area? And I went, sure, that sounds like fun. So next weekend, I meet him at Kit Kat Club, and there's no one out there. These guys aren't there. I'm like, well, we'll take a walk, because there's a bunch of clubs in the area. And sure as shit, we walk like two blocks over, and there's a different dude. And he's like, that is exactly what you just described to me. And I went, I know.
Hmm.
Let's go talk to them.
Oh.
So we did. And these guys were shockingly open about what they were doing and why they were there. And they're like, yeah, cops don't show up. Clubs want to be safe, so they hire us, and we just kind of patrol these X blocks. I went, okay, fascinating. He goes, do you want to go out again next weekend? And I said, sure. Because this is an interesting story. So we go out next weekend, and again, we find different groups of people, including some characters who make, you know, end up making the cover. There's a security firm called Ravencrest.
Okay, so that does sound like a Harry Potter house.
It really does. Oh, it gets better.
Or like a 1980s sort of buddy cop drama. I don't know. You know, like, I'm Sergeant Ravencrest, you know?
I don't know. Dude, wait, it gets better. So we meet the guy who is the head of Ravencrest, who founded it.
Oh, wow. So they're local.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. It's run by this former army. And he founded a private security firm in like 2016 or something and called it Ravencrest, because what else are you going to call it? Like, that is like, if you said, what do you think a business called Ravencrest would do? And I'd be like, I don't know, probably armed security. It just sounds like it.
Like, yeah. Or it's a golf club. I don't know.
Well, that too. That's a good point. What's your name? I'm Ghost.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. That was his call sign, was Ghost.
Oh, wow. This really is a Harry Potter house.
Wow.
Oh, it gets better. So then we start talking to these dudes. And again, they're like, oh, yeah, you know, we've got like all telling us about how, you know, many guys he has, where they patrol, like just blatant, like just telling us everything. And again, Aaron Mesh is a good reporter. He goes, hi, I'm Aaron Mesh from the Willamette Week. He doesn't bullshit you where he's from. He's not trying to, like, you know, sneak you into that kind of shit.
No fucking yellow journalism bullshit or anything.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he's not lying. Like, when he identifies himself as press.
Yeah.
And he's old school, too. He's got, like, the fucking notepad and everything. And so then we meet this guy named Jean-Pierre. And Jean-Pierre is a character. He is, like, just a mountain of a man. Just tall, lean, ripped. He said he was former Navy SEAL. There's some hesitancy about whether that was true or not, but he had a Navy SEAL tattoo on his chest. Allegedly a Navy SEAL.
Allegedly.
And
Navy SEALs.
But this guy was ripped, and these drunk girls getting out of the club were just like fondling his biceps. It was a very weird thing. And you know what his call sign was?
Uh-oh.
Reaper.
Ghost and Reaper. Oh my God. This is a Shadowrun team.
Say, this is a game. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And then so, you know, we start walking back. We get to finally, after like 3 weekends of going out, like, we see cops down there. And there's like 8 of them just in a little cluster. And I asked them what they think about private security, because Aaron knows that if he asks them, they're not going to talk to him. Because he identifies himself as a reporter. Mm. But me, concerned citizen Xander, what do you think about all these armed guards downtown? Well, we hate it. We don't think it's good. Well, we just don't have the manpower to go and, you know, patrol Old Town anymore. Because back in the day, they used to block off the streets and have cops everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
That's gone. And the cops just basically don't show up. We're talking to some club owners, and they're like, yeah, unless it's like a gunshot, they're not going to show up for 45 minutes to anything.
Mm.
So there's a lot of gunfire in downtown right now.
There's a lot of gunfire all over. There were 100 shots or more fired just a couple nights ago in Park Rose. Yep.
It's kind of Wild West.
Yeah.
Right now. Portland's kind of getting back to its roots a little bit.
This is my kind of thumbs up. No, it's bad.
It's bad. Yeah. It's bad. It's not good, actually. Yeah. All you anarchists are like, you know what lawlessness actually looks like? It's not cool.
So then after that, I went out for like the fourth weekend in a row with Aaron. And when he meets me this time, he has another journalist with him, Tess Rieke, Justin Yao, who's a photojournalist. And I forget the other person's name, who's also a photojournalist. But there was like 4 of them showed up.
Hmm.
And I'm starting to think, this actually probably is a big story. like a local indie paper doesn't send out 4 people if I'm not planning on making this a big story.
Yeah.
So we start patrolling at one point. So obviously we run into Ghost and Reaper again, because they're always in the same area.
Ghost, Reaper.
Because they're everywhere.
And nowhere. And at one point, like, you know, they mentioned that they keep an AR-15 in one of his, in Ghost's trunk of his SUV.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And his SUV has bulletproof, like, doors and windows, and they're like, you know, in case gunfire happens, we can just put patrons behind the SUV so they don't get hit. And I'm like, this is like this is what you do in a fucking war zone.
This is literally the plot of a campaign of Shadowrun that I ran where the characters started their own private security company this way. They had an SUV that they zombified, you know, they turned into a zombie wagon.
Oh, no.
They had just a whole bunch of shotguns and assault rifles in the trunk of a limo that yep. they beefed up and they started an empire.
Yeah, except this is actually happening, like... 6 miles from
Part
us.
Of me is like, this sounds really cool, but most of me is like, oh, fuck. We've yeah. gotten to that point.
Right, because Shadowrun's supposed to take place in Seattle, not Portland.
Shadowrun is a dystopian, dark future that we're supposed to avoid.
Oh, that's where you're going with this. Okay, sorry. My yeah. bad. Okay. Yeah. It wasn't geography. It was the whole nature of the dark, crumbling world around us. Okay. Yes.
Well, just as an aside on that, one of the main story points of the backstory of Shadowrun, of the history of the world and how it came to be the way it came to be in the game, was that the citizens of Seattle and the government of that area got so fed up with the shitty worthlessness of their actual police that they fired the entire police force and hired a private security company to function as their police force. And thus, Lone Star, the great mega corporation of police security, was formed, and they're a main, you know, part, they're a main threat in a Shadowrun game.
I didn't even make the Shadowrun connection, and now everything that you're saying right now between Portland police and all these armed private security guards is coming way too frightfully clear right now.
We are on the border of that happening. Like, I know we've already passed the Mayan into the world. I know we've already passed when the ghost dance was supposed to happen, and I know nobody's goblinized, but I do think that very soon our police forces are going to be replaced by private security firms.
Yeah,
before
I mean,
I die.
We're already down like 140 officers in Portland right now.
Because they quit or what?
It's a combination of a lot of them just retired after last year because they're just like, fuck being a cop.
Well,
once the DA in town started prosecuting them for their immense brutality last mm-hmm. year, a bunch more just quit. Mm-hmm. And so, again, it's a tricky thing right now in Old Town and in Portland in general, because you have a mixture of a bunch of bad eggs in the cops, a bunch of, you know, black bloc and anarchist kids that want to just fight the cops, and cops like fighting them. It's a thing. Frustration at the police forces for their lack of doing anything about when far right wing militia types come to town and harass people.
Like literal terrorists
come to town. The cops are like, I mean, what could we possibly do to help? Also, half our forces are with them today. We just don't have the numbers. Yeah. So,
I guess we'll just let them take over this abandoned Kmart parking lot and let them do their thing.
KKK Mart. God damn it, Nathaniel. That was fucking hilarious. Yeah. So, anyways, this story ends up becoming the cover story of the Willamette Week for that week. And we also learned, too, that almost every single one of the private security people that's hired, at least by Ravencrest, are all former soldiers. Mm-hmm. So because of that, and just talking to Ghost and Reaper, funny to say out loud, just talking to Ghost, you know, again, who the guy who owns the company, he says he prefers to hire former soldiers because he wants to give veterans jobs. But again, the big question was, who are they accountable to? What training do they get? Mm-hmm. And on top of that as well, the other question was, well, you have soldiers who are used to battle in downtown where, yes, it's been sketchy, more sketchy as of late, but also having soldiers in a not battlefield thinking it's a battlefield, what does that lead to? And those are basically the questions that were brought up in this article mm-hmm. that Aaron and Tess wrote.
Yeah.
So
that's interesting because having spoken with a lot of veterans over my last couple of years, you know, it depends on a lot of things, right? Depends on who was their commanding officer, where were they stationed, lots and lots of different things. But a lot of these guys went to Afghanistan and like were protecting schools.
Yeah.
Like they were making sure the little girls could go to school, you know? So like there's that kind of quote unquote battlefield And then there's the, you know, the
Corn and Gull Valley,
the front line. You know, there's so many different kinds of stories and different kinds of soldiers.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But a lot of them do feel a responsibility to keep Americans safe and are real pissed off at the last 4 years. So, you know, hey, maybe that's their way of sort of atoning. I don't know. It's interesting.
I will say, though, talking to Ghost and Reaper.
I know. Amazing.
It's so good.
I can't not laugh.
It's so good.
I'm sorry if you're listening, guys. I hope you understand the humor behind this. First off, I want to say those are some cool tags. But second,
they're great.
The fact that you're talking to people named Ghost and Reaper who are armed in the middle of an urban area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anyway, sorry.
Shadowrun, it's fine.
Yes.
We're trying to find some. It's a little bit of gallows humor in the reality, which is Portland right now. Mm.
I will say, though, that both of them were extremely nice.
Yeah.
They were very professional, and especially talking to Reaper, you know, he, again, like you were just saying earlier, Poppy, he thoroughly believed what he was doing was the right thing to do as a former soldier, mm-hmm. was to go and protect people. He said continuously, all I want to do is make sure that people get home safe. That's it. Yep. That's why I'm here. That's why I do this job.
If you were ever in the USA military, it is your literal actual job to protect us from fascism. If you think otherwise, I don't know where you went wrong.
Yeah. And but again, the whole, and I'll just end on this. The whole thing was just like, okay, cops have not been held accountable for a very long time, if ever. I don't know who these guys are accountable to.
Yeah.
They're not part of the government. That's my only concern. And that's kind of the point of the article. You can go to Willamette Week. You can look up, you know, like ex-soldiers and Old Town or whatever the title was. You can read it. There's actually a picture of my motorcycle helmet in one of the shots.
Nice.
Thanks, Justin Yao. Oh, and Matt, shout out to Justin Yao real quick. First off, Justin Yao is a great dude. If any of you other motherfuckers in the left-wing activist scene go and mistake him for Andy No because he's Asian and beat him up again, I will hunt you down, because that has happened more times than once. Secondly, Justin Yao was also the guy who was in the photojournalist, was also the guy in downtown a couple weeks ago when that fucking right-wing lunatic was tearing what looked like an AR-15, but it was actually an airsoft rifle.
Yeah,
he
didn't get shot because he was white.
Oh, 100%.
100%.
But,
okay.
But Justin Yao was down there photographing this dude when the guy pulled up his rifle and, like, within 10 feet away, put it to his face, finger on the trigger, and Justin Yao just kept taking pictures.
Wow.
Fucking nerves of steel, that motherfucker.
Fucking.
Didn't realize until later the gun was not real. Also, he's an Army veteran, so if anybody could tell, it would have been him. Mm-hmm. And yet, at that distance, airsoft rifles look real.
And at night.
And
right?
At night.
Yeah.
And yet he still kept taking pictures.
I never thought in my lifetime ever would fucking downtown Portland, Oregon be like fucking Tiananmen Square or some shit. Like, this is really weird.
Yeah.
So all I wanted to say was, you know, this is complicated, right?
Very.
This harkens me back to our first season. This harkens me back to our first season episode, episode we did about helmet laws versus social responsibility, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas, okay, well, if the cops are so corrupt that nobody is showing up when people are in danger, okay, fucking A, we got to do something about it. On the other hand, we've seen what happens when our prisons were privatized, and that is
not good.
No bueno. Again, who are these people accountable to? But is accountability to our government
any better
right now?
I know that's the whole thing. It's very complicated.
It's very, very complicated, and I don't know the answer. But you know, it is an interesting story, and it's going to be interesting to see what happens here in Portland over the next couple of years.
Yeah, or even the next couple of months, honestly. But yeah. I will say, if you see Ghost or Reaper in downtown, say hi. They're real friendly. They're real friendly guys. They're real nice. Go and give Reaper's biceps a nice little squeeze. They are impressive. Goddamn.
I mean, it would be an interesting. I mean, I think it would be a very interesting question to ask them as a citizen, to say, so what happens if you shoot somebody and you get sued? Like, do you have legal protection? Like, how does that work? I mean, I'd be very interested to know how that, I mean, obviously they've got some kind of open carry permit or something, or I don't know. Anyway.
Yeah, they're DPSST certified.
What does that stand for?
It's whatever certification you have to get to become an actual security guard. I'm sure
Jacob knows, but he isn't here yet. So, you know.
He just rolled in and is just looking for real handsome over there.
See, I was trying to lie to our listener. Call me out.
Well, he
shout out to Brandon.
He just like ninja'd in here.
And they don't have to take that much more training to get certified with a firearm. Like, it's significantly less than what cops have to do. So again, it's this whole kind of balance question.
Oh, I really want to know what Jacob thinks about all of this. He just got here.
But anyways, if you go to Old Town, stay safe out there. Don't get too drunk because it's weird. And say hi to Ghost and Reaper. They're cool dudes.
Yeah. And if you're going during daylight hours, like, please patronize the local businesses down there that are still sticking it out. Like, skip the chains, skip the whatever, the corporate bullshit. Like,
buy local.
Buy local. Let's bring downtown Portland back, y'all.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening. Drink up, drink up, drink up, and order again. This is the last call for alcohol. Get going. Drink up, drink up, drink up, then order again.
So what do y'all think of the whiskey?
It's tasty. This goes down a little too easy, I'm going to say. A little too easy.
Yeah.
I don't have any left.
Yeah, I don't either.
Because it's in my belly.
Yep. It's good to sip, though. I didn't, like, knock it back. It's a good sipping whiskey.
I definitely didn't want to shoot it. Mm-hmm. I definitely wanted to sip and savor it. It was nice and mellow, especially with a couple cubes in there. I thought it was quite delicious.
One final note before we call this episode good. If you worked for Ravencrest, what would your call sign be?
Culpepper.
Hawthorne.
Oh, I don't know. What would be mine, guys? I don't have any good Poppy. Ideas. Just not Poppy. No.
Pumpkin.
Falcon.
Nope. Pumpkin.
You're Pumpkin.
Just Pumpkin. I'm just call sign Pumpkin.
Yep.
Because that's what I turn to at midnight because I'm real tired.
Unless you want to be Jane O'Lantern.
Midnight. More like 9 o'clock.
I know. Oh. Right? Oh, my God. I'm so tired. Yeah.
All right. Let's go ahead and close this out. What was the name of the article again, Xander?
It's something like ex-soldiers patrolling downtown or something like that. If you go to WWEEK, that's WWEEK.com, it's probably still one of their most top mentioned articles. You can find it pretty easily, I'm sure.
All right. If I can find it, I will include it in the show notes. Anyway, you've been listening to Bikers, Dice, and Bars, recorded here in Portland, Oregon. I'm NPC.
Oh, there's a spot for Jacob. Hi, I'm Dr. Xander Gerrymander. It's been nice to see you.
I am Poppy Beaujolais.
And we wish to remind you to please check us out online on our Discord server. Join us on Facebook or tweet at us. And also, keep it rubber side down.
Always tip your bartender.
And be sure to roll those crits. They're very valuable.
And please always drink responsibly.
Unless you're in Wisconsin, then drink Wisconsinly.
No.
No. Okay.
Drink responsibly.
Thanks for joining us, friend. We've reached the end of Bikers, Dice.